given the fact that it's a pay-as-you-go system, and given the fact that we're talking in 2033, we may have to make some adjustments, is it also true that there are more people depending on Social Security as their primary income, and then just the gross numbers being larger due to the graying of America? Can you sort of talk to me about those two issues?
Well, yeah, that's, you know, that's really true. We do have more people relying on Social Security because we have a reduction in the pension system in the United States. Fewer and fewer employees actually have pensions, which is a defined benefit. You get a monthly check for the rest of your life. More employers have been going to a 401k or 403b, some kind of employer-based savings program. And the reality is that about the average savings for people is around $80,000 in these 401ks. So it's not enough to live on for the rest of your life. And this burden to save for retirement has been shifted to the worker. And because of that, Social Security is playing a bigger and bigger role for the future. You know, in my parents' generation, my dad, for example, was a Teamster. He had a Teamster retirement plan. He had the VA health benefits. He had Social Security. He was in really good shape. You know, some of us in the family now, we don't have that kind of same safety net in retirement. And so Social Security picks up almost a bigger meaning for people if they don't.
And periodically, you know, there were not continual cost of living adjustments, but by and large, it does. You know, when gas, you know, what 2 or 3 months ago when it was real high, probably did not at that particular moment in time. You know, gas prices went down.
Is there any discussion of making things like gas part of that actuarial table, or no? It's just not factored in the CPI.
Well, you know, there have been a lot of discussions on how if the cost of living adjustment is fair. And if not, but I don't think that's one of the proposals really being looked at right this minute. The other thing that's been very high for seniors is the cost of health care, which is the highest rate of inflation, and that's also not really adjusted into the cost of living adjustment for Social Security. But there are very few programs that provide any cost of living adjustment, and Social Security is one that does provide that cost of living adjustment, which we call a COLA. And will last you for your entire life.
Okay, so it does some of that, but it leaves some other things out. But those other things that are left out, they're not part of any proposal at this juncture, just to be clear, right?
Correct, they're not a part at this particular juncture.
Now, one of the questions that we also have here speaks to retiring at 62 years of age as opposed to 65, and then the proposals that exist about upping the retirement age even further. This question says, if I retire at 62 as opposed to 65, how does this affect my benefits? What's the answer to that?
To begin the answer to that, when we ask people, one, to consult the annual Social Security statement that everyone gets. It indicates, and it says it on there, if you were to retire at age 62, this is what your monthly benefit would be, 63, 64, 65. Okay, so it says there, based upon the earnings of that particular point. We also ask people to call Social Security to get an accurate assessment of what they earn, because they have an up-to-the-minute itemization of what it is it costs. So if you go and retire at 62, you need to be aware. One, that snapshot of where you are, those will be your earnings that you will have for the rest of your life. So you need to analyze factually, can I survive on this? Will I need more money? Should I delay 62 to 63 to 64? And so that's what it is. So the decision is yours based upon your need, but you need to consult both your Social Security office and your annual statement.
And I might follow up with Daniel's comment that if you are looking about when should you retire, it is a very personal decision, but AARP actually has tools on our website, aarp.org, that has a retirement planning calculator, so you can plug in all the different kinds of income you expect to have, how much you need to live on each month, and you can do some projections based upon the calculator. It's really easy to use. I've used it myself, and it's very, very simple, and it gives you a very good picture where you need to be. I think a lot of people underestimate maybe how much money they're going to need later on. It's hard for us to plan 5 years ahead, let alone, you know, 25 years ahead. And one of the things that I always worry about, especially are single women, because if you live alone, that's you're having a harder time sharing expenses because you're paying all of them by yourself. And women tend to live longer than men do too. So if they're taking their Social Security benefit early and they're being their benefits cut by about 25% by taking it at 62 versus the full retirement age at 66, they're, when they're older, it could be a big reduction in benefits.
Okay. Well, that's an important point to make, and I do want to talk more about how you should calculate that and maybe some recommendations about when to look at that, and we'll get back to that in just a minute. We're going to take a break, and then we'll be right back.